Yeah. What in the church?
Everybody's trying to preach short. I don't know about you, but I was brainwashed.
All right, come on. You know what I'm saying?
I needed a brainwash. I was so screwed up in the head. I was so lost. I was so twisted. I was so just gone. And we were washed by the blood of Jesus.
Come on.
Regenerated by the word of God. And the mind and the brain is being renewed continuously while we read the Bible.
Amen.
Come on.
When you read your Bible, that's when you renew your mind.
Yes, sir.
So if you don't read your Bible, your mind is never renewed, and it begins to decay.
Yeah.
All right? It's just like anything that is supposed to be refrigerated. If you do not refrigerate it, it may not go bad one day. It may not go bad the second day. It may even last a couple of days. But sooner or later, deterioration takes place. Sooner or later, bacteria begins to come alive, and it deteriorates. It's the same thing with our minds.
Yeah,
so I'm glad taking Pastor Gabriel said about the offering, taking it in a different direction, that my brain was washed with the blood. But I understand that the minute I stopped climbing that mountain of ice, I begin to slide back.
Right, yeah. Come on.
And my mind begins to go back. How many know our mind goes back quick?
Yes, yeah. Right. Oh, yeah, come on.
Isn't it a trip how much work it takes to renew your mind?
Yes.
And how quickly you just slide back to square one?
Yeah.
So be aware of that. I want to preach today out of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 23. And I want to encourage you just to go forward. My wife and I, we were now central in our mother church. It was a very, very difficult time there. Not because it's just our pastor of almost 40 years. He went to be with the Lord. It was very emotional because we see our friends and brothers and sisters who we grew up under Pastor Alvarez's ministry. And I'm telling you, I was preaching. I kept expecting him to come out of the door where his office is at.
Wow,
any minute now, he's going to come out. You know what I'm talking about? And it was really emotional. It was really emotionally draining. We had a Holy Ghost time there. God moved powerfully and mightily. And all we do is we ask that you keep praying for our mother church, El Centro. Pray for Sister Dora and the girls. You know, he had four daughters. Pray for the girls. And then pray for Pastor Lorenzo that's taking over the El Centro Church. Amen. And Brother Peter, and I think her name is Jocelyn or something like that from the Rialto Church. They're taking it over. That he was a director there. So pray for the for everybody that God's doing the work. I want to just preach really short today because it's Katie's birthday. Christ.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 23. I just want to focus on one verse. The Bible says you are Christ's, and Christ is God's.
Amen.
You are Christ. God the Father gave his Son for us, and through that sacrifice of the cross, he purchased us. Now understand this. Jesus talks continuously about him being the groom and the church being the bride. Yes? And so, in biblical days, unlike today, biblical days, if you wanted to marry someone, you had to present a dowry, a huge down payment to the father of the bride.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the dowries were ridiculous sometimes. They knew, man, if you're loved, you got to pay whatever you need to pay.
Oh, no.
And so Jesus Christ paid a huge dowry for you and I.
Amen. Come on.
Amen. He purchased us with his own blood, not with just words or with words, but he purchased us with his blood. And so in Corinthians, the Bible tells us that something that we need to always be aware. If you will just listen to me today, it will ruin you for certain things. When you understand you are Christ, it's hard to sin.
Come on.
Sinning is easy once you do it.
Yep.
It's easy, you know. Once you're there, once you cross the line, man, of course it's easy.
Yeah.
And it's fun for that moment.
Come on.
And it's enjoyable for a season, according to the book of Hebrews of Moses. But, you know, when you understand I am Christ, you begin to ask yourself, shall I do this great sin against God?
Yeah.
Yes, come on.
I belong to Christ. I am Christ. You are Christ. We belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. A huge dowry was paid so that he could not purchase, but so that there could be this even exchange between the Father and the Son for the bride. And if we have to understand that it goes deeper than just metaphors. Oh, we're the bride, he's the groom, God the Father. This is deep, man.
Yes.
This is deep. He that is joined to the Lord has become one spirit with the Lord. Do you even grasp that? So what the Bible does to try to get us to understand, he gives us an example of when a man marries a woman, in that moment of intimacy, their souls become one.
Right.
Okay, the Bible says, you know, the man shall leave his father and his mother, and they shall cleave onto his wife, and the wife, and they become one. This is not just a metaphor.
Yeah.
There's a danger when you read your Bible that you just think they're metaphors. Mm-hmm. They're reality. And so the Bible is trying to give us an understanding that something supernatural takes place when a woman is joined to a man. And yes, they said their vows. And on the outside, there's this promise to be faithful to one another, to in sickness or in health, for better, for worse, and for richer, for poorer. And there's this exchange of vows that are a commitment made to the world in front of them. But it is that night. It is in that moment of intimacy, that evening, where something supernatural happens, their souls become tied, and the two become one.
Yes.
Using that example, the Bible says, they that are joined to the Lord have become one spirit with the Lord. I love the way Benny Hinn put it. He said, God made it so that you cannot be unjoined.
Come on.
To the Lord. It's like you cannot unscramble an egg.
Right. Come on.
If you're in relationship with God and in covenant with God, you can't just dismiss that. That's why the devil is such a liar. When he comes to you and you mess up or you do something dumb or something sinful, and he's so quick to come and tell you, oh, you're not saved, you're lost, or you blew it, it's over, and it's bad. But the blood of Jesus covers our sins.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Even after 10,000 sins, his love for us is as infinite as it ever was. Hallelujah. And so we have to understand that we are Christ. And Christ is God. And so if we are Christ, because God has consecrated us to Jesus Christ, therefore we need to understand that our labor is to be with Christ. Now, I can so appreciate you guys. Most of us worked today. You came to church against everything inside of you, right?
Come on. For real.
God. Why can't I just call in sick? Oh, I'm the pastor. I forgot. I am emotionally drained. It has been very, very hard. I was telling Pastor Gibb, I never in my world thought it was going to hit me so hard about Pastor Alvarez. I've lost really good, dear friends. Pastor Rigo, Pastor Gina, Darko. I've lost close friends. Rigo was, man, you don't even know how far back me and Rigo Munoz went. And losing him, there was this heaviness. But man, losing your pastor, it's at another level. It's been very emotionally draining. It has been very emotionally hard to see my brethren in Al Cedro Church have them break down right there before my eyes. You know, some of them said to me, they said, I have not allowed myself to break down. I have been holding it in. But now that you're here, I'm just going to let it out. And this, it's not like I'm Superman. Yeah, you know, go ahead and let it out. Brother, I'm as broken as they are.
Yeah, come on.
But yet here we are. Because we understand we belong to him.
Yes, man.
Yes, he
Amen. And yeah, you're tired, but here you are. And yes, sometimes a worship team, we have a 20 worship team choir. Amen. And sometimes it's Amanda. You know, at least we know for sure every service we're going to have Amanda.
Come on.
And then we have the head usher, Brother Rudy. He's the head usher of all the ushers.
Come on.
<That's
fine.
laughs> Well, you got it, huh? See, we understand we are Christ. My daughter drove from Palmdale just to come to church tonight.
Amen.
And, you know, because you understand you are Christ. Anybody can watch it on Facebook and social media. That's great. That's what we're here to do. That's why we're putting it out there like that. But you know what? We are Christ, man. And it's important for us to be in the church of Jesus Christ, to get together with the brethren, to just be a part of what God is doing in that physical moment, in that place. And if we are Christ, then we need to understand that not only are we heirs with God, we have become joint heirs with Christ.
Yes,
did you know that the Bible says that Jesus Christ was the firstborn from the dead? And what that means is, in modern terms, he's the prototype of what every one of us is supposed to be.
Yes, amen.
We are heirs with God, and we are joint heirs with Christ.
Amen.
You are Christ, friend. You're not on your own. You have a place of authority as a Christian. You are in a place of power. You're in a place of prayer.
Come on.
You know, Joe Biden was inaugurated today. We need to pray for our president.
Yes, come on.
He's our president.
Yes.
We need to pray for his administration.
Yes.
Because it affects our whole country.
Yes.
We need to pray for our country. We need to pray. And we're in that place of authority because we are Christ. We are heirs with God and joint heirs with Christ Jesus.
Come on.
The El Centro Church, and it always reminds me of that. I preached there and they gave me a love offering, and they have a check, and that check needs two signatures. That check is no good if one person signs it. Two people have to always sign it. The treasurer of the church, the treasurer slash secretary, Sister Alma, and Pastor Alvarez, or the new pastor, Sister Dora. As long as two people sign that check, that money is going to be given to you.
Amen.
But if that check is only signed by one person, it's no good. Are you with me?
Amen.
Yeah.
We are joint heirs with Christ. It's as if God, in the name of Jesus, by the power of the blood, has given us these blank checks, and they have to be signed by Jesus, and they have to be signed by you.
Amen. Come on.
It doesn't do any good, saints of God, to just have the checks in your drawer. How many can say amen?
Come on.
You have to make use of them. You have to stamp them with your warfare. You have to take authority. You have to bind and rebuke and be in agreement with the Lord Jesus Christ and the will of God. Align yourself with what God wants to do. What do you want God to do? Then start putting, understanding that you are Christ, heir with God, joint heir with Jesus. So take your place in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When we are tempted by sin, we should scream, I belong to
yes,
God.
Come on.
You'll notice, folks, I know temptation comes.
Yes.
I know it does. Because we're in the flesh. And for everybody it's different. But I'm telling you, folks, when we begin to declare, no, I am Christ. Then Joseph, when he understood, he has a covenant with God. He said, shall I do this great evil deed? I can't do this. This is messed up. David, when he had sin and hidden his sin, and hope everything went all right, 9 months later, Naaman exposes him and he says, I have sinned against God.
Yeah.
I have sinned against God. He understood, I belong to God.
Yeah.
I belong to him. And when you do sin, if you feel bad, that's a good thing.
Come on.
Yes.
That's a good thing, folks. Because you're in covenant with God. You're in relationship with God. And we should be screaming, I belong to Christ.
Amen.
Temptation comes to everybody. And God always, the Bible says, and no matter how much you're tempted, there will be a moment of where you can actually get out of that temptation. God will always provide a door of escape. You hear me today?
Right.
Something will happen. Some anything could happen that just gives you that edge in that specific moment where you are about to take a dive into the world of sin, and God just gives you that lucid moment, that moment of clarity where you can say, I am Christ.
Amen.
Shall I do this great sin against Christ, the one who loved me and gave himself for me, the one who paid the dowry to the Father with his own blood, not by the blood of goats, not by the blood of lambs, but by his own blood. He entered the Holy of Holies and he brought us before God and he cleanses us and purifies us so that we would be standing before him without wrinkle, without stain, without anything that will corrupt the beauty that Jesus produced in you and I. We need to say in temptation, I am Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
I belong to him. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
You know, folks, most of the time, people get saved with nothing. At least in our church. That's just this year. I don't know how it is.
The what?
Arnett and the Furnace Church. You have all the lawyers.
Come on.
And you know what? It is when people come, they have nothing, they get saved, they give their life to Jesus, they're doing good. Once God begins to bless their lives, to prosper their lives, they come with nothing. As God begins to bless their marriages, their relationships, their finances, they get jobs, they get cars, they get an apartment, they get a house, whatever. It is right there where prosperity begins to whisper in your ear.
Yeah.
Hey, don't get too crazy.
Come on.
Don't get too crazy. And it is right there where you have to say, no, I am Christ.
Oh, yeah, come on.
I am Christ. The life that I now live, I live for the Son of God who loved me.
Yes.
And gave himself for me.
Yeah.
I am Christ. Folks, God will prosper you and prosper you and prosper you and prosper you as long as it doesn't take root in your heart.
Yes.
It doesn't become your idol.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow,
I was talking, you know, if you didn't see the services Sunday morning, as I pled with my church, I call it my church because that's my church where I grew up in.
Yes.
This is my church that I pastor. That's my church where I go for shelter. And as I was pleading with the brethren and the sister, and I was saying, hey, guys, what's it going to be, man? And I remember talking to some of the older men out in the parking lot. These are older men. Older men that have been around. They've pastored for years here. They're missionaries. They've been around. And I remember, you know, just talking to them. And here are older, gray-headed, tired, been out pastoring and back. And them saying, you know what, I'm done with this. I'm just going to grab my Bible study and we're going to go hit the streets again.
Come on.
You know what, I don't care what happens. We're going to start doing this. And there was a stirring there. And you know, all that happened that morning was they remembered, I am Christ.
Yeah.
I'm tired. My wife had COVID and almost died. I'm tired. My wife died from COVID. I'm tired. And there's something that's still, even in the midst of all that pain, that hurt, and that tiredness, there's this breath of fresh air when you realize that you are Christ.
Amen. Come on, sir.
I mean, I don't know what else to tell you. How can we motivate ourselves if not by reminding ourselves who we belong to? And so even in prosperity and blessing and with experience, because see what happens is sometimes we begin to mature and to grow in the things of God, and we got a lot of experience. At least that's like Albert Cisneros says. He said we become a legend in our own minds.
Come on.
Right? I just love when he would say that. And what happens, folks, is we forget who we belong to.
Come on.
Yeah. Come on.
Oh, but I sacrificed so much. Paul says, I'll spend and be spent for. You know, my pastor used to quote that all the time. I will richly, he says, I will gladly spend and be spent for souls.
Come on.
He would always say that. And I remember we grew up talking that talk, I'll spend and be spent for. I'll take what I got, I'll spend it, I'll be spent for the kingdom, I'll be spent for the cause. Because you understand, you are Christ.
Yeah.
It's not just a social meeting here. This is not an AA or any type of social meeting or what have you. This is God meeting with his children, and we are reminded that we belong to Christ. No sacrifice is too big. No sacrifice is too great. Yeah, we're tired. Yeah, we push ourselves. But once we're here, you realize why
Come on.
Hallelujah. And when you give and when you tithe, we don't do it because we have so much abundance that God's darn it, I might as well tithe and nothing else to do with my money.
Come on.
I don't know how your tithes are. But mine, I'm blessed.
Amen. Come on.
I'm blessed.
Hallelujah.
Bro.
That's right.
And I can easily make a couple car payments or buy me some electronic goodies. Praise the Lord.
Sushi.
Whatever your thing is.
Yeah.
But I am Christ.
Sure. Come on.
Yes.
And he gets the first fruits of everything.
Amen.
Amen. He gets the first fruits of everything. I've been really tired lately. I know it sounds like the story of my life, but you know, my age, working, and then ministry, and then running to El Centro, running over here, and doing this, and doing that, catches up to you sometimes. And you know, I know you think you're invincible right now, but after a while, after a certain age limit, it really begins to catch up to you.
Right.
And it's like, I remember walking to my car today from work, and I said, man, God, when am I going to get to rest? When am I get to rest? And God doesn't even, you know, it's funny, because God doesn't even answer me. He just ignores me. He doesn't care. He's like, hey, don't forget who you belong to.
Right, come on.
Come on.
Come on.
You're purchased with the blood. I ransomed you.
Yes,
you know the word ransom? Do you know what the word ransom means? The one used in the Bible, that's when you would ransom or you would redeem or pay for a slave that was being sold in the slave block. And you would ransom them, you would pay. How much? Okay, now you belong to me.
Mm-hmm.
But he's a good master. How many can say
amen?
So he took me in when nobody wanted to buy me.
Come on.
He took me in with him.
Come on.
And death was the only solution.
Yes, wow, sir. Come on.
I'm serious, man.
Preach.
You know, I work. We come from the Imperial Valley where they have feedlots where there's animals. And you know, when people don't buy certain cows or pigs or whatever, for whatever the reason is, you know what they do? They shoot them. They shoot them. What do you think? They're going to be feeding them even though nobody wants them? They're just taking up a food and they just shoot them and they bury them. Well, they throw them in a hole. Well, that's what we did one time. We threw them in a hole, poured a bunch of gasoline, and lit it up.
Come on.
What else can you do?
Yeah.
That was my only future with death and flames.
Mm-hmm. Come on, that's right.
Come on, say
nobody
that.
Wanted me.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because of the great love with which he loved me.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
He raised me. He raised me up with Christ and set me at the right hand of the Father. We're at the same level as Jesus Christ himself.
Yeah.
Because I am in Christ. I am in the faith. Therefore, I am seated at the right hand of the Father right now. God demonstrated his love. And he continues to demonstrate that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. So don't forget, saints, that we are Christ. When you want to complain about ministry and you know, I've been extremely zealous for the Lord God, for the people, right? They've abandoned your covenant. They've torn down your altars. And I alone am left, oh God. And you want to get, you need a reason to be bitter about it.
Come on.
And God said, don't forget, you are Christ.
Come on.
That's right, say that, come
and
on.
You paid a heavy price. And brother, I'm telling you, when Christ took me in, I didn't put conditions. How many of you say, well, God, I'm going to do this, but just letting you know right now, things are going to... Did you put any conditions there?
Come on.
We were so messed up. We thought we were hallucinating. You know, I used to have nightmares inside my nightmares.
Sure. Yep.
Yeah.
I used to have nightmares that I was vaccinated, and then I would have another nightmare that I was killed while I was vaccinated.
Yep. 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 Like, yes, yes, sir. Come on.
Can you imagine?
Come on. Oh, yeah.
He just took us in, man, and our minds couldn't process the fact that somebody would take somebody out of the miry clay.
Yes.
And set her foot on the rock of Jesus Christ, on the solid reality of being a Christian. Hallelujah. See, if we're going to be and understand that we belong to Christ, then we should have godly character. How many can say that? Yes or no?
Yes, amen.
The Bible says that evildoers that want to speak against us, by our good works, we'll put them to silence. Listen to me. I know you have godly character here. But we have to have godly character at work.
Come on.
And if people are bumming around doing nothing, your company is paying you to do something.
Come on.
Don't ever forget that. And the Bible takes it a step further. It says that we are to work wherever we work, whatever we're supposed to be doing, work as if you're working unto the Lord. Is that how you would act?
Come on.
If Jesus was your boss and
come
he was
on.
There?
Yeah. Come on.
Huh?
Come on.
Is that the kind of attitude you would have? Is that the kind of slack attitude you would
say
have?
That. Come on, say that.
Come on, saints. We are Christ.
Yeah. That's right.
And he delights when his children, even in unfairness, keep going forward. Keep working hard. Keep doing what they're doing. Keep living how they're living. Hallelujah. Our conduct. The Bible says, you know, in the Bible, conduct and character are used interchangeably. As far as God is concerned, it's the same thing. Our conduct is really our character of our heart.
Yeah.
And here, the Corinthian church was a very affluent church. They were hooked up. They compared Corinth to modern-day San Francisco. Not only was it as perverse as probably worse, way worse than San Francisco, but they were very prosperous, and they had a lot of material things and what have you. And so here in the Bible, it's challenging people that are at that level in life. Don't forget, you are Christ.
Yes.
You are Christ. You are Christ. Again, Christ loved the church and he died for the church, folks.
Yes.
The doors have been opened. The bills are still being paid.
Amen. Come on.
Come to church.
Yes.
Bring somebody to church. Did you forget you are Christ? And your master has ordered you to go into all the world, preach the gospel, make disciples. Your master has ordered you to tell people about him. Yes?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Unless you are no longer Christ. You are, but you're not acting like you are. You're not acting like you are. Spurgeon said, you know, he said, I wouldn't give a penny for somebody's Christianity that doesn't cause them to tell other people about their experience.
Yeah.
I'm going to give a penny for that, he said. What kind of encounter with God cannot move us to tell somebody about Jesus?
Come on.
Yeah.
How can we have an encounter with Jesus Christ, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and not care for our neighbor's soul?
Yeah.
Or our family's soul? Or our co-workers? How can people come into our path, whether it be at work, at school, at home, wherever, and you know there's an opportunity? Because, I mean, have you ever had the Holy Ghost just kind of tap you?
Amen, yes. Come on.
You know what I'm talking about, sir. Entonces se hace, ¿verdad?
Come on.
You know what's up. You just kind of...
Come on, say that, come on.
Don't you know you are Christ? And if he says witness, we got to witness.
Amen.
And if he says speak, you got to speak.
That's right.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, or as a... Now, translation says, if God's done anything for you, speak up. You are Christ, church. We are Christ. We should have godly character. We should have this attitude of this constant just awareness that we belong to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah. Amen.
Yes, sir.
A while back, working for the gas company, one of my supervisors, they ride with you occasionally. They'll come and they'll just walk with you for like 4 hours. My God, it's like I have to work for real for 4 hours. And they say, don't forget, Alex. He goes, man, right nowadays, people buy cameras on Amazon for $40, high definition. He goes, they put them in their houses, they put them in their yards. I'm sure you've seen stories on Facebook or Instagram, people doing bad things, the camera catches them. And he said, don't forget, Alex, somebody's always watching.
Yeah, come on.
Come on.
Thanks. Thanks for the encouraging words. And, you know, I think we need to remind ourselves, don't forget,
yeah,
that we are Christ.
Yes.
Come on.
He doesn't have to be watching. You're aware.
Yeah.
That you are Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
He doesn't have to be reminding you. You know, I need to live clean.
Yeah.
You know, I got to live a holy life, man. How many of you would like prayer, power in prayer? Come on, folks.
Amen. Amen.
You can, you know, holiness is essential to power in prayer.
Yes.
You hear me today?
Amen.
Holiness is essential to power in prayer. You cannot have power or drive in prayer if you can't keep your heart clean.
Yeah.
Everybody got that?
Yes.
God, this is an issue of God not forgiving you or cleansing you. That's not the issue. The issue is you want power in prayer. It's holiness essential to that. And we have to be constantly almost like the Nazarite when they would make a Nazarite vow. Says, hey, if you're gonna make a Nazarite vow, you gotta remember you can't drink wine, the fruit of the vine, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then what else? He says, and you shouldn't even be eating the grapes of the fruit of the vine, you know? And then he takes it a step further. And for those of you that want to really get technical, do not eat the raisins.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy? God says, are you serious? You want to consecrate your life? A Nazarite vow was a voluntary vow. I want to devote myself to God. I want to consecrate my life. Therefore, I'm going to stay away from alcohol, wine, grapes, raisins.
Come on.
Look at me, folks. Just as the minute before we start drinking, we start eating the grapes of Sodom, soon we'll start drinking the wine of Gomorrah.
Come on.
Do you know it, man?
Come on.
That was deep.
And there's no power in prayer, man. There's no power in our lives because we've forgotten. We're drunk in our own pleasures.
Come on.
And when you're drunk, you don't care who you belong to.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's true.
You don't care.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible says continuously be sober. Sober minded. Sed sobrios. Sober. Stop thinking like a drunk. And when you understand, oh, I am Christ, I got to abstain from this because I am Christ. Now everybody wants technicalities. Like I said, California, you can smoke weed, right?
Yes.
It's okay.
Yes.
It's okay. Mm-hmm. I go to Carbonero right there, and I buy pupusas right there during my lunch hour sometimes in the area. I'll order, and by the time I park, so many people go in and out of all walks of life, of all nationalities, old, young, and they all walk in there in a hurry, and they walk in there upset, and they come out happy. Because they got their little package.
Yeah.
Come on.
So now America's saying, hey, it's okay, Christians smoke weed. It's okay. You know, before you know, we're going to be drunk in the wine of Gomorrah.
Come on.
We have to get it together, saints.
Yeah.
We belong to Christ. Be holy, because I am holy. Amen. And holy is not to be, listen, holiness is not to be misinterpreted and as of holiness is perfection. Holiness means you are set apart for a sacred use. You've been consecrated. You've been set apart. You are holy. That's why God is holy, because he is in a class all by himself. He is apart from anybody. You can't compare him to anyone or anything because he is holy.
Come on.
He's in a class all by himself. And God says to you, he's not saying be perfect. We aspire for perfection, but God's done. I don't even come close to that.
Come on.
But holiness is about consecrating your life. Okay.
Amen.
Maybe it's not a sin, but if it looks bad,
yeah,
maybe I should abstain from appearances of evil because I am Christ. I won't let idols form in my heart. Our idols of prosperity or pride or arrogance. See, friend, we got to get it together today and every day. And we must always continuously remind ourselves that we belong to Christ.
Yes,
Christ. And the life that I now live, I live for the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's not about me no more.
Sir, come on.
It's about who we belong to. Now, I got to fight to try to live a life well pleasing unto God. You will fail miserably, continuously. But that's why the cross is there. That's why the blood of Jesus is there. And I close with this. As one man said, he said, I need the blood of Jesus and the sacrifice of the cross as much today, just as much as when I got saved.
Amen. Yes.
We don't need it less.
No.
We need it just as much.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
So understand that we're not going to be perfect. We aspire for that. We live to live a consecrated, separated life unto God. And because that's how we want to be in tune with him. And it's really hard to get, you know, substance out of the Bible reading when you're in sin.
Mm-hmm.
When you're doing bad things, it's just hard. It takes a while to get oriented. It's not that God doesn't love his mind, he's so corrupted. And then they have to be brainwashed again with the blood. Amen?
Amen.
So understand this today. If you want to get anything out of today, just get this. I belong to Christ.
Yes.
Therefore, I gotta be more cautious, walk circumspectly. That word circumspectly means cautious.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. If you're watching this evening, you are not a Christian, I want to invite you to become a servant of Jesus Christ. Friend, I talked about by choice. One time our lives were so deteriorated. We were so deluded. We were so lost. We were so bound. And not necessarily with vices of addictions and what have you. Some of us were. But for other people, it could be just sheer depression or suicide or so many things that can just dominate a person's life. And we bow before Jesus. We ask Jesus to take us in. We ask him to forgive us of our sins. And God saved us. And now we serve God out of a pure heart. We understand I am Christ. But I don't have a problem with that. I'm glad I'm Christ. I tried running my own life. I made a mess.
Yeah, come on.
So as a Christian, it is a delight. It is our pleasure. It is our honor to belong to Christ. I am Christ. I belong to Jesus by choice. Anytime could we just pick up and leave. But guess what? I've surrendered my life to him. And he's a good Lord. And he's a good Savior. And he's a good Master. And if there was someone or something better out there, we would have been out there doing it. But there isn't. Been there, done that. And we all in this church came to that one conclusion. I need God.
Come on.
This evening you're saying, preacher, I feel you. I need God. Or maybe you're a backslider. Sin got the best of you. It's okay. No matter. What matters is there's hope for you.
Yes.
Friend, if you're saying, man, it's time, I want to give my life to God. All you have to do is repeat a simple prayer, but you got to say it with your heart. You got to mean it. Okay? And speak it out loud because it's a confession. I want you to say after me, say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Forgive me of all my sin.
Forgive me of all my sins.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I repent.
I
invite you to my heart
as
my Lord and Savior.
And
from this day on, I'll serve you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Friend, if you said this prayer, your life will change forever. You have been brought into the household of God, and you know what? Now you are Christ's.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All your sins are forgiven. You start a new life. What we would like to do is to help you grow as a Christian. Whoever invited you to watch the service online, we would ask that you please contact that person, call them, text them, meet with them, and let them know, hey, I accepted Jesus. What do I do next? Because we want to help you grow in God. You can contact us. Our phone number is on the Facebook page information. We have a website there. You can email us. You can text us. You can just let us help you grow in your new life and your new experience with Jesus. Friend, I'm talking to the Christian now. Sometimes we forget that we are Christ. We are prone to forget. That's just in our human nature. Hallelujah. I think the only thing that we never forget is our grudges, right? Those we are experts, right? But for some reason, anything else we forget. Friend, we belong to Christ. But don't forget, you belong to Christ by choice. You weren't coerced. You weren't coerced. We didn't trick you into saying the prayer.
Come on.
We didn't trick you into getting involved in ministry. Oh my God, this is not what I signed up for.
No. Come on. Yeah.
Your life is not your own.
Come on.
You were bought and paid for a price. How can we not rejoice that we are His? God has spoken to hearts today. There's some things we need to deal with. I don't know what it is, but there's got to be something. Just put on another song, Jules. Anything that has a little bit of life in it. Who cares if they mute us? God's dealt with hearts. You know how I tell the people that don't know Jesus to mean what the prayer to say with their hearts? Don't just amen the preaching, but let it be moving in your life. Let it change and let it help you. God has spoken to hearts, and when we stand, you come and you make some commitments. You talk to God. If you're watching online, hey, man, don't forget you are Christ. Your life is not your own. It's not for us to pick and choose anymore. He is the shot caller of our lives. That's what it means. Let's all stand right now. Let's all stand. Why don't you come and find a place to pray at the salt if you're watching. Kneel down right there before the King at your house, apartment, wherever you're at. Just kneel before Jesus. Let God help you. Let God meet with you. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Sunday morning, we're going to have a Holy Ghost service. You know what we're about? I think last Sunday morning, it was the one before. I don't know how it was last Sunday, but I wasn't here. But the one before, we had a lot of people.
Amen.
We had visitors. It was a good Holy Ghost time. So come on, if you're watching, you're able to come, come. If you've never been to our church before, you've been watching, come. You know, you enjoy it. You'll have a blessed time.
Amen.
We bless you. We thank you for being here. I'm going to ask Brother Julius to dismiss us in prayer.
Hey, Father, we thank you so much for your mighty word. We thank you for being just faithful to us. Help us, Lord, to continue to break ground, to find the methods that are applicable right now. I pray in the name of Jesus, put those people that we specifically can reach and bring into this church to know you, Jesus. Bring them across our path that we may witness to them. The word of faith, continue to bless us, Lord, in our vision, to clearly understand what we personally can do in our lives to bring the kingdom here on earth and manifest it the way it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Amen. Amen. Amen.